This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes.
The Plotaholics podcast is not meant to make light of those with an actual serious addiction. If you have an actual serious addiction, the Plotaholics podcast should not be used as a replacement for treatment. If you are not in a treatment program for substance abuse, and you are somehow still offended, then fuck you too. Sincerely, your host.
Episode 2.
All right, everybody, welcome back to the Plotaholics. We did not get canceled after our first week, even. And mostly, I think, because...
It was touch and go.
Well, mostly, I think you just can't cancel a podcast. But anyway, welcome back. You know, we started things off last week with a B movie. The King of
I think we could probably make that up. A C movie. That's maybe even D.
Fair point. But, you know, we didn't want to pigeonhole ourselves and just talk about bad movies all the time. And so this week we celebrate the 20th anniversary of The Matrix.
Oh my God, yes. Such a great...
Yeah, and we're going to get into that in just a little bit. But we wanted to start with a brand new segment, On the Radar.
Captain... There's something on the radar.
What is it?
It appears to be incoming movies and television shows and other geeky pop culture happenings.
Well, don't just end there. Tell me what to be excited about.
Brian, On the Radar is where we talk a little bit about the things that we're looking forward to.
Yep, some stuff that we have coming up. And the stuff, yeah, we're looking forward to with pop culture. I'm excited. This is an exciting time to be a geek, man. It really is.
It absolutely is. Yeah, I completely agree with you. You know, I think first we want to say that we are going to team up with Joe Compton from Go Indie Now on an Avengers or just really a Marvel Cinematic Universe smorgasbord.
Do you have your tickets for Endgame yet, Shane?
You know, I don't, and I know I need to get them.
Yes, you do.
I know I do, and I will be getting them very soon. But we will be joining Joe Compton over on the Go Indie Now channel for a Marvel Cinematic Universe retrospective where we look back at the last 10 years of Marvel movies. And then the week after Endgame comes out, we will have our very... special Endgame episode of the Plotaholics, and Joe will be joining us for that as well.
This is going to be so... This next month of the Plotaholics is going to be dynamite!
Yeah, man. We got some bangers coming up, for sure. Some club bangers. So, the next thing, and we got a couple of big sort of like nerd geek kind of drops this week beyond Endgame stuff, and the next thing that I... want to talk about is Disney Plus. We finally got details, or more details at least, of what Disney's streaming service is going to look like. And at $7 a month, Brian, I don't know that anybody's going to be able to compete with that.
I'll tell you something right now. Almighty Overlord Eisner, just take my money and my soul now, please.
Yeah.
Just take it. $7 a month or $70 a year,
right,
for all Disney content.
And now,
everything Marvel, everything Star Wars, everything Pixar, everything, even stuff, Shane, even stuff in the Disney vault. It's unvaulted now.
Yeah.
It's unvaulted.
The Disney vault is Disney Plus. You know, like,
yes,
you're going to be able to see all of those movies that, you know, for a long time, when we were coming up, they would say, we're going to open the vault and we're going to release a special DVD edition of The Little Mermaid, but it's only going to be available for like these two or three movies we're going to put out this year. And this is the only year you're going to be able to get them. But now you're going to be able to stream all of that stuff on Disney Plus.
And that is so amazing.
Additionally, because of this like very recent acquisition of the entertainment division of 20th Century Fox.
Oh my God. We're going to have so much stuff to watch. so much great older stuff. The Simpsons, Shane. The entire Simpsons.
30 seasons of The Simpsons will be there. So, like, just to sort of give you the, I think a sense of how big this possibly could be. You're talking about a company now that, by all measures, owns the rights to stream. Will eventually, right, own the rights to stream any animated series on Fox, all seasons. Mm-hmm. That would include not just The Simpsons, but Family Guy, American Dad, Bob's Burgers,
Cleveland Show,
like Bob's all Burgers. Of these shows. Yeah, and now this is an interesting thing to me, Brian, and this is what I'm kind of excited about. Is that, yeah, so like $6.99 gets you Disney Plus, right? But we also know that Disney, because of their buyout of that particular part of Fox, it also gives them a controlling stake in Hulu, and they also already own ESPN Plus.
Yeah.
And so now you're looking at the possibility of a standalone service that could give you Hulu, Disney, and ESPN. And remember that Hulu also has a live option where you can get, like, live streaming cable, essentially.
Yes. Yes, you can.
And if that's the case, like, if you're looking potential for, like, a $20, like, if they're charging $7 for Disney Plus, then for $20, you could get cable.
Yes.
You know, like,
Disney wins. Disney wins the world.
Yeah.
Huh, I've got it all. Yeah. It's all mine. It's all mine, you bitches.
Ah! I do believe, man, that, like, you know, they're predicting somewhere between 60 and 95 million subscribers in the first year.
I'm going to be one of them.
Yeah, I will be too.
If they would let me pre-subscribe, I would today.
Yeah. And they don't even really have to give me a lot of stuff, like, to make me do that.
No, they really don't. You know what? Just give me what you... Just give me... Even if they came out and said, look, we're going to do some of this stuff sporadically. We're going to start out with the classic Disney movies and go from there. You know what? I'd pitch in for that.
Look, man, I'm ready to pay $7 for the Jon Favreau Mandalorian series alone.
Oh, my God. That is going to be so... The one thing, and I have to... As much as I'm excited, there is one thing that I have to wave the doo-doo stick. One thing. No Charlie Cox, no Mike Coulter, no Finn Jones, no Kristen Ritter as the Defenders. That is the only thing that sort of craps on it all. That is the only thing.
You know, you're getting, like, I think a really good sample tonight of what the Plotaholics are really going to be about.
Absolutely.
And what are the Plotaholics about? Plotaholics are about drinking and about having a good time and about talking shit, about shooting the shit, talking about stories, talking about the things that they're passionate about. And to that end, Brian Tan, I submit to you Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker.
Now, I have watched the teaser trailer about 50 times now. You and I were talking with Joe Compton earlier today when the title broke. Mm. And I lost my shit.
It's true.
Because I don't like the title.
Yeah.
However, I love the trailer. And oh my God, if you have not seen this trailer yet, number one, you're either Amish or you're living under a rock. And if you are Amish... I tell you right now, violate your oaths to the church, get to an internet connection, and watch this damn teaser.
Get to an internet connection and watch all of the other 8 movies and then watch this teaser trailer.
Oh my God, yes. Daisy Ridley oh my God.
Daisy Ridley is a badass. Like, I don't care.
She is monstrous. Oh my God. God, did you see her? She's just standing in the desert. And she's like, like she's breathing heavy. And then it's like she calms herself. She remembers who she is. And then it's like, you know what? Me worry? Oh, look, a TIE fighter's coming at me. Watch my capoeira leap with my lightsaber prepared to do some damage.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, no big deal. I'm just hanging out in the desert fighting TIE fighters.
Yes. I can just, you know what? I'm just going to take out a TIE fighter right now. You know what? I haven't done this today.
You know, there's one scene in that teaser where Rey and Poe and Finn are all sort of standing on a grassy hillside.
Yes.
And they look like they're about ready to open for Mumford and Sons.
There does look like there's something afoot there. And I am pumped. Like, everyone looks like, in the first movie, you had Finn and Rey who are like really, really nervous. And throughout, now this is what character progression is all about. Yeah. This is amazing character progression between these characters. Finn, like, I'm going to start with Finn because they threw me for a swerve. I thought Finn was going to be the Jedi, and it turned out to be Rey. Yeah. But I mean, you looked at Finn and how nervous he is and how unsure he is in episode 7. Episode 8, he's like, you know what? I don't want to be involved, just like Han was. Mm-hmm. He didn't really want to get involved. He was afraid. And then Rose got him to give a shit.
Yeah.
Not to mention the fact that as much as he cares about Rey and as much as he cares about Poe, he cares more about them than running away. And then now to see him standing there, he looks like a battle-tested, tough guy.
I think that there is some deliberate misdirection happening with that title. And the more I think about it, the more I'm convinced that that's the case. Here's what I think is happening. I think that Abrams and company are trolling the vast group of trolls. They're retrolling the trolls, right? That yes. hated The Last Jedi, that wanted Rey to be attached to the Skywalkers somehow. And I think that what you're really going to get is not the rise of Rey as a Skywalker, but the rise of the Skywalker mythos. Like,
okay,
Luke has passed on now. Yeah, and now sadly. Is the moment that he was already sort of larger than life. There was a lot of dialogue in The Last Jedi about how that alluded to these ideas of like creating myths out of men, and that he was never that big of a deal, you know? And I think that all this title is really signifying is that in his death, he becomes that big of a deal, that he represents sort of the kid that comes from nothing and becomes the Jedi or whatever. You know what I mean? Much like Rey.
Yeah,
I'm not ready to buy the title as a sellout of Rian Johnson's vision.
I'm not either, honestly. I loved The Last Jedi.
It is, and yeah, it's one of my favorite Star Wars films.
It absolutely is.
The thing I feel that most Star Wars fans did not like about Episode 8 was there was this sense of like nihilistic despair, which is going to lead us right into The Matrix, by the way.
Yes, it is. Because that is awesome.
A lot of complaints were like, well, why did they go to this planet? Like, they didn't even get what they needed. And that's kind of the point, man, because like every mission doesn't give you what you need. Like,
exactly.
If you like your Star Wars movies where every single thing works out at every turn, then absolutely, I can introduce you to a guy named George Lucas, and he is so bad at telling stories sometimes.
Oh, absolutely.
That his own fandom turned against him. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
And so Rian Johnson gives us a movie where at every turn, things seem... He took the hopelessness...
They had to overcome. They had to overcome things.
He took the hopelessness that we were given at the end of Empire Strikes Back and dialed it to 10. You know, like...
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
And I always believe this about trilogies. The strength of the second film, the strength of the middle chapter is always going to be in flux until we get the third chapter.
Exactly. And I'll tell you something. The one tagline that I put out for us is film review from an author's point of view. And I think that when it comes to a serial or a trilogy, as opposed to a standalone, your storytelling is different. Your writing is different. Everything is different from trilogy to standalone. It's always different.
Oh, yeah.
Because you've really got to tie up all your... If you miss a couple of strings in a standalone, in a regular standalone, then you can kind of fix that. You can sort of explain that away. But if you go with a trilogy... and you don't tie up your loose ends, you've got a pissed off fan base that wants nothing else. You have now let them down.
Yep. Absolutely. So, here we go. Here is the real meat and potatoes of this episode. Let's get into it.
This is going to be great.
The Matrix.
The Matrix.
20 years, man.
20 years. Now, when did you go see The Matrix? Did you go see it as soon as it came out, or did you wait a little bit?
So when The Matrix came out, it would have been 1999.
Yes. Yep, March 31st, 1999.
And in 1999, in March of 1999, I would have been, oh man, get ready for it, in eighth grade. Ready.
Wow. I don't even want to tell you where I was, man.
I'm pretty sure that The Matrix wasn't on my eighth grade radar in terms of a cinematic film. I'm pretty sure I caught that when it came to video or DVD for the first time. I don't remember seeing it in the theater.
Do you want to know where I was?
Where were you?
March 31st, 1999, I was 19 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I was working at the Carnegie Science Center in the North Shore of Pittsburgh. Now, just to let you know how far back this is, they were building Heinz Field in PNC Park.
Oh, okay.
If I have my time correct.
Yeah. So you're talking a good, 15, probably 14 years before Bane blew up Heinz Field.
Yes, absolutely. And I'll tell you, back then, for those of you who are too young to remember, Keanu Reeves wasn't a big deal in Hollywood. He was Ted. That's literally, he was Ted. I mean, he did Bram Stoker's Dracula, which I hate to say it because I love Keanu Reeves, but he was the weakest link of Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Yeah, I've been trying to think about what else he had done before The Matrix, other than Speed. Bill and Ted.
Speed. He did Bill and Ted. He did Speed. He did Point Break. He did, oh my God, what was that? Give me 2 seconds. He also, I mean, he had done some stuff that wasn't, like I said, even though he did these movies, he was Ted.
Yeah.
And that's really all he was.
He was really, it seems he was trying to make that transition out of Bill and Ted and into like a more serious action star. Mm-hmm. Speed was a pretty dope movie, I gotta admit.
Speed was great. Point Break was great. I love Point Break. All right, so this is, and since we're saying Ted, this is the start of Keanu Reeves's, filmography.
Yeah.
1989. Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. The Parenthood. I Love You to Death. Tune In Tomorrow. Two movies that I never saw, never even heard of. Point Break. Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. My Own Private Idaho. Bram Stoker's Dracula. And Much Ado About Nothing. Mm-hmm. Little Buddha. He actually had an uncredited cameo in Poetic Justice with Tupac and Janet Jackson, for those of you who don't know. Freaked with Alex Winter, his Bill and Ted counterpart. And then I'm skipping over this other one, but Even Cowgirls Get the Blues from Gus Van Sant. Then he did Speed in 94, then Johnny Mnemonic, and then when he did Johnny Mnemonic, he kind of sort of, because Johnny Mnemonic was a dumpster fire, it really was. You know, I'm not going to loop it through Jones and like sugarcoat it. It sucked. He had a couple of other flicks that weren't all that great. Then he did The Devil's Advocate, which was, at that time, his best film. He really fed off of the energy of Al Pacino and turned out a great experience, especially with a then unknown Charlize Theron. And then...
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a great movie. Devil's Advocate, solid.
Devil's Advocate is an amazing film. And then he did The Matrix. So really, he only had, I'm talking like really serious critical acclaim, he only had like a movie.
Yeah.
So The Matrix, obviously, it saved his career.
Yeah, he was decent in Much Ado About Nothing in terms of like Shakespeare films, but like Shakespeare films mm-hmm. never really do that well. And no, I don't remember not, it getting really. Much critical acclaim, but like that was a fine adaptation of that movie.
I agree. I was a fan. And Speed, I really enjoyed Speed. See, this was a time when Keanu Reeves needed good co-stars to bring out his talent, because he was great as Jack Traven. Johnny Mnemonic was, it's a guilty pleasure of mine. I own it on DVD. It's a guilty pleasure, but it wasn't a good movie.
We get to The Matrix, and when Keanu Reeves becomes Neo, it feels like it feels like the role was made for
him. He was meant for. It really does. And I'll tell you something right now. This movie, when the film gods came up with when the Wachowskis, then known as Andy and Larry, now I respect the fact, you know, they're Lily and Lily and Lana. Sorry, I did not mean to show them any disrespect by referring to them by their what they're previously known as. Mm-hmm. But when the Wachowskis, when the idea for The Matrix came to the Wachowskis by the movie gods, it was like, only Keanu Reeves can do this.
Yeah. Before we get too far into it, why don't you read us the IMDb one-line summary of The Matrix?
I am pumped.
Then we will get into our Matrix talk proper.
A computer hacker learns from mysterious rebels about the true nature of his reality and his role in the war against its controllers. Oh, man.
That's a solid one-line summary for sure.
It truly is. Because, now keep in mind, when I first heard of The Matrix, the first time I saw the first trailer of The Matrix, I thought it was okay. I thought it was interesting. But then I was kind of like, man, but it's Keanu Reeves. I don't know.
I wanted to start our talk about The Matrix with a brand new segment called Drinking Games. So welcome to the very first edition of the Plotaholics Play Drinking Games, where typically Brian and I will quiz each other on random trivial facts, or maybe even just pose hypothetical questions related to this week's subject matter to each other. Brian, I will ask you the first question, if you don't mind.
I'm all for it. I am game, my friend. Let's do it.
All right. It's kind of a two-parter,
I will say this before you ask. I am not using Wikipedia or Internet Movie Database for this. I have them pulled up to answer questions that you ask me, but other than that, these answers are coming right off the top of my head.
There you go. So, in a typical drinking game fashion, if one of us misses the question, we will drink. If one of us gets the question right, then the other person will drink.
All right. This is a fun game.
I think so. It'll make the second half of this episode a lot more interesting with the question mark. All right. So question one.
Okay.
And then I want to talk about it after the answer is revealed. What actors were originally considered for Neo and Morpheus?
For Neo, I know of two right off the top of my head. Will Smith and Nicolas Cage.
Will Smith was absolutely the answer I was going for. I definitely want to talk about that. But now give me your Morpheus answer.
Oh, man. All right. I'm going to guess. Let me ask you this before I answer.
Okay.
They were not looking for a black man per se. It was just someone who could pull off the character, correct?
Right.
I would have to go with Denzel Washington.
That is a wrong answer.
Well, guess I got to take a drink.
I drank for Will Smith. You drink for Denzel Washington. The actual answer again, according to the very limited research that I did earlier today, is yes, Will Smith was originally considered for Neo and pitched the part of Neo, and Val Kilmer was approached.
Val Kilmer! Yeah. Coming off of Batman Forever. All right.
Actually, maybe when Batman Forever came out, they were like, never mind.
Yeah, I would have taken a look at Batman Forever and just like, nah. Right, no, thanks, Val. When we're going to do Real Genius 2, we'll call you.
That's my first question. What do you have, Sir Tan?
All right. Here's what I have for you. Let me see if I can word this properly so it's understood. The character switched. What about this character was going to be unique that would set her different between herself and her Nebuchadnezzar crewmates?
Oh, God. And so this was like original sort of like pre-production sort of stuff?
Yes.
Oh, would she be, maybe she would be part machine?
Negative, sir. Ah,
that would have been a pretty cool plot point, though.
What it was going to be, and it was going to actually have a lot to do with her name, Switch. Mm. When she was in the real world, she would be herself. But when she went to the machine world, she'd become a male.
Oh.
That's hence the name Switch.
Like it.
But what they ended up doing was that they had her... I don't even want to disrespect her and say androgynous. She was just a badass.
Yeah.
She was... I'm sorry. Like, one of the things that I really loved about The Matrix... Soon as Keanu Reeves, and I'm not trying to jump ahead, I'm really not. I just for the point of how cool Switch is. Neo just gets into the back seat, bam, gun right into his face.
Yeah.
And she is not playing around. She is gonna unload that entire clip in his face. And then she just goes, "Listen, Coppertop, we don't have time for 20 questions." It's like, oh, this and at the time. You don't know what that means.
Right.
But it's like, dude, she is bad ass.
Yeah, and, you know, you bring up androgyny, and it's something that I want to get into as we go along, once we get into, like, our discussion of the actual film itself. Because,
right.
There's a lot going on there, too. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But you're drinking. You took your drink.
I took my drink. Yes, absolutely.
I heard you. Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's my next question, and we'll just do two each. That should be
enough. All right, that works.
What is the what book does Neo hide his discs in?
It's right on the tip of my tongue. I know it's like it's almost considered like a nihilist Bible.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, you know what? The name escapes me, and I am not going to cheat by looking it up. So yeah, I'm going to take a drink.
It is called Simulation and Simulacra by a guy named Jean Baudrillard, who is a, like you said, a leader in nihilist philosophy, postmodernism, and everything. And it's really the work that the movie is based on.
Yes.
The idea that in our contemporary society, how do we know what is real? It seems that we are more apt to encounter simulations of the real than the actual thing itself. Mm-hmm.
This was required reading for the cast.
I was about to say that. This and a couple of other books of postmodern theory as well. Cast members and crew members, a lot of them had to be able to explain those books and explain what The Matrix was before they were even allowed to be a part of the project.
That is amazing. Kudos to the Wachowskis, man.
Yeah.
Really. All right. Let me see if I mean that is a good one. Let me see if I can come up with something. All right. Let's see. A little bit of trivia on this. Okay. Which member of the cast of The Matrix was also in another project known as The Matrix?
Oh, God. There was another thing known as The Matrix? Mm-hmm. So that clearly means that I'm not going to know the answer. oh, wait. Do you mean The Matrix Reloaded? Because I'll have to say...
No. It is not going to be that easy, my friend. I'm sorry.
What is... I'm going to guess the chick that played Trinity. I can't remember her name right now.
Carrie-Ann Moss. That is correct.
Wow.
You are correct. That was the Hail Mary, my friend.
Yeah, it was.
She played Liz Teal in the 1993 television show Matrix. 13 episodes. So, you win. Nice. You win the inaugural Plotaholics drinking game.
No, I love it.
Fanfare! Fanfare!
All right.
You're the best around! Nothing's gonna ever keep you down!
Love it. I love it. Good to see. You know, honestly, that's the song you should have sang for your voice audition.
Yeah, I probably should have. You know what? I actually have to yell at Sharon because, like, why didn't you suggest singing "You're the Best Around" from The Karate Kid? What
right,
the hell?
You're the best around in that crazy falsetto voice too. Like,
oh yeah. Oh my God. If you know what, after that, they just have to offer me a record deal.
Or maybe, you know, you would just skip the competition and they would just put you in Adam Levine's chair.
Oh, that would be great, because, I mean, come on, Adam Levine is not going to hit a falsetto like I can. Not like that. No.
No. You know what? I can 100% guarantee that Adam Levine will never hit a falsetto exactly like that.
Absolutely not. Mr. Levine, if you ever listen to this, and you probably won't, but if you do, my falsetto is completely unique from you, because I'm the best around! Nothing's going to ever keep me down!
Love it. I love it. All right. So now let's get into our talk. You know, it's only 30-something, 40-something minutes into this thing. Let's get into our talk
proper. This is
going to
be so about The Matrix.
The Matrix, yeah. So I thought we would probably just go act by act and sort of talk about how
I'm totally fine with that.
Develop and turn out, and then we'll get into our rating system. Okay, so before we get into it, it should be noted that The Matrix is an incredibly philosophy-heavy film.
It truly is. And I'll tell you something. As a young 19-year-old, I was very paranoid after seeing this movie. I was so paranoid. This movie made me question reality. It truly did. Because I started, because this movie, it, the mystique of this film, and I hate to say, and the discussion of the sequels is for another episode, obviously, but the sequels took away a lot of the mystique. It wasn't this movie that took away the mystique. It was the sequels that did.
Yeah, I believe that this movie should have been a standalone.
I agree. I absolutely agree.
It is a masterpiece if it's a standalone.
It truly is. And I mean, you know, we're talking about philosophy, and this is courtesy of Wikipedia.com. It says, the film contains numerous allusions to philosophical and religious ideas, including existentialism, Marxism, feminism, Buddhism, nihilism, and postmodernism. There's so much philosophy. And just, this is an action movie that makes you think. It's not all just glitz and glam.
Right.
The glitz and glam comes, but it makes you think.
Absolutely. And so I posted on the Plotaholics Facebook page a little while ago a video explaining the allegory of the cave, which is a concept that was introduced a way ass long time ago by Plato. And the Matrix, as a vehicle for philosophy, is kind of a retelling of Plato's cave. So Plato was working with a theory that people who were unlearned in the different forms of reality, what certain things look like or what they were, right? That they would not be able to distinguish a simulation from the thing itself, right? And so in the allegory of the cave, Plato says there are people chained up in a cave. They are not allowed to leave, and they've never known the world outside of the cave. Behind them, and unbeknownst to them, there's a fire burning. There's a light source, right? And then there's sort of a catwalk or a bridge behind them as well, where people essentially put on a puppet show. And then the puppet show is broadcast in front of them on the cave wall in the form of shadows, right?
Okay.
because these people have never been outside of the cave, they believe that the shadows that they see are the actual things themselves. So if there's a puppet of a cat, they see a shadow of a cat, and they believe that that is a cat. And it's because they've never been outside of the cave to experience the real life cat, you know?
Okay, right.
And so it poses the question, and The Matrix also poses the question, how do you know if you're experiencing reality if you've never experienced reality?
Right. That is such an amazing question.
And it's something that Elon Musk, who actually might be Keanu Reeves, has asked, right? I mean, Elon Musk has also posed this question. He believes that it's very possible that we could be in a simulation. I think that we might be in a simulation. I've definitely experienced real life glitches in the Matrix, you know?
I have as well, absolutely. And what's to say that we're not?
Yeah.
There's nothing to say that we're not. I mean, when you look at the world the way it is today, I mean, it's crazy how things seem to go from bad to worse, but every generation previous always think that their time was better than where they're at.
Yeah.
And it's like, dude, like, it's the same thing. You don't see history repeating itself.
You know, I don't want to go down this road too far, because we need to get into a into a conversation about craft. But you know, sometimes I think, like, okay, some of my favorite music is like blues music, right? From, you know, the 40s and 50s or whatever.
Right.
And I think, you know, those are great songs and those are great artists. But, like, did those people really exist, or is the simulation just feeding me that shit, you know?
That's a good question.
And it's honestly something that we'll never know. And if you watch Westworld, then if we poke at this too much, then we'll get shut down and our memories will be erased. So we should probably just
stop there. Or worse comes to worse, one of the folks in your house might suddenly be wearing a black suit and sunglasses and put a 50 caliber slug into your heart.
There you go. Right. So
be careful.
let's get to the opening of The Matrix. Matrix opens with a killer action sequence.
Well, before we even get to that, what I really enjoy, what really sets the tone, is it's an amazing, number one, the score is outstanding.
Absolutely.
The score is, it sets the tone for everything the movie is. And then you've got this code and this conversation between Trinity and Cypher that at the time, you're like, what the hell is going on here?
And yeah, then, actually, let's have a moment for the Wachowski's dedication to the cyberpunk aesthetic. Because absolutely, it's not just that inside of the film things look this way, but they even put the Warner Brothers logo through this binary code, right? So, like, from the jump, this thing is...
It's different. It's total different immersion. From anything... It's totally different than anything Warner Brothers did. And they suck you into that world before the movie even starts.
Yeah.
And it's outstanding. And then when it starts, we see Trinity, and it's just from the back, just working on a computer. She's in the seedy hotel. And then, you know, the cops plow their way in. And it's like, okay. And at the time, you know, we were just starting to know what you know, cyber crimes were. Mm-hmm. You know, if you'd seen Hackers with Angelina Jolie and Johnny Lee Miller, it's like, okay, cops do this when you're breaking computer crimes, they kick your door down. Okay. And then you get the suits.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy who plays the lieutenant, and I want to watch it again. I intended to watch it one more time before we recorded, but I didn't have a chance. I was actually looking at his chevrons in his, his brass to see if he actually was a lieutenant. Because I will say this, and this is the one continuity error that bugged me. A lieutenant, unless it's a serious crime, is not going to be there.
Right.
You'll probably have, like, the sergeant. You'll have, like, a sergeant there.
Yeah.
but you're not going to have a lieutenant. That a lieutenant is a suit. The suits don't get involved in street stuff.
Right.
But, you know, Hugo Weaving is just, you know, as soon as he comes on screen, he commands your attention.
Absolutely. Well, and you could say the same about almost anybody in this film, really.
Right.
And so we get this opening action set piece, and part of what makes the opening act of this movie so effective is what you referred to earlier as the mystique. It's not confusing because they're not giving you a whole bunch of stuff. It's just interesting because they're presenting you with a world that looks very much like the one that you know, but there's something that's just a little off. And I point to some instances of what has been termed, bullet time.
Yes.
The bullet time special effect, everybody knows it as the one where Neo bends over backwards and the bullets go by him and you can see the ripples off of them. But even in this opening scene, you have some instances of that kind of thing going on. And before you see Neo manipulate time,
it's Trinity.
Right, right. And before it becomes obvious that that's what they're doing, that they are actually manipulating time, it really just looks like a kind of interesting camera shot and an interesting special effect, right? It just looks like they took a different...
Yeah, it's just, wow.
Yeah,
They're pausing her.
But that, I think that stylistic choice, especially since it's something that we had not seen in movies before, is one of those little clues that sort of puts the audience onto the fact that something isn't quite the same about this world. It's still, you know, like they could have absolutely held that bullet time and just let Neo do it. Then, you know, it would have been a different thing. But that's one of those very early clues to the audience, or what I would say the reader, right? That this is a world it's a world that looks like ours, but it's not exactly like ours.
Absolutely. And then, you know, she takes the cops out. My whole thing is, how the hell? They're all armed. What the hell? And then she just disarms them literally like they're nothing. And a great, in an amazingly choreographed fight scene. And then, you know, then she's on the phone. Are there any agents? Yes. God damn it. And it's like, the suits. Like,
This dude looks legitimately like Tommy Lee Jones just walked off the set of Men in Black.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. And it's like, well, what's the big deal about them? This broad just took out like four guys.
Yeah.
And then, you know, then she sees them and it's just like, oh shit. And she's gone.
Yeah.
And he's giving chase and these cops are, you know, coming after her and, you know, they're leaping rooftop to rooftop. And you can actually start to see the cops are keeping up. They're not keeping up. They're not keeping up. Yeah. One almost falls off the roof. And then it's just, we're just going to jump the length, a street length, to the next building.
Right. And that's that moment, right, where you're like, okay.
That's impossible. The cop is great at plotaholicsing.
Right, because it looks like somebody hacked a video game. Which is exactly the point, right? Because what we learn is that the world that we know is not reality. It is a simulation. And the people that are working with Morpheus are hip to that. And so because of that, they are able to manipulate that reality and play it something like a video game.
Now, the one thing, the big difference, though, in... I don't know if a lot of people notice this, but the way, and you're talking about manipulating like a video game, that's a great point by you, because when Trinity lands, she has to do an athletic tumble to keep going.
Uh-huh.
When Agent Brown leaps, he does the Deadpool coined superhero landing.
Right.
Where it's just like, boom, what?
Yeah, the agents, man, when they run and jump, they are just like berserker. You know, like they're just, there's no stop. to their pursuit, and
really isn't.
Yeah,
and it's terrifying. Yeah. You're like, and the music gives you this thriller-esque, like, oh my god, is she gonna get away? And then when the cop is just like wide-eyed, that's impossible. It's like, no shit.
Yeah. Now let's talk about a really interesting sort of, I think, revelation here, and that is, you just said it, like, you're worried, is she gonna get away? And mm-hmm. and I think what makes this opening action sequence so interesting is that we somehow intuitively know that she's the one we're pulling for, even right. though she's the one being chased by the quote-unquote good guys.
Right. And it's like, all right, well, she, and they even says, we're gonna kill him. So it's like, that's all right, somebody is in danger. But yeah, and I think what it is that it's that brute, that overshadowing, that mystique, that almost, what's the word I'm looking for? It's almost like that presence of the agent lets you know, no, we don't want him to win.
Yeah,
no.
I completely agree with you. And so when you talk about world building, and mm-hmm. when you talk about, from a writerly perspective, showing and not telling, right? Mm-hmm. It would have been really simple for this movie to have exposition dumped and told us about these agents. And it does eventually. But, yeah,
but not at the very beginning.
Right, but
I want to have my idea.
It is able to show us just through pure physicality and a slight, subtle little difference between the way these two characters land on a roof that they mm-hmm. are vastly different kinds of creatures.
Absolutely.
And which one? And it's able to use that one subtle little motion to show us who is the superior physical creature or simulation, and then who is also the good guy and the bad guy, right? Because we know it's sort of like one of those archetypal sort of things that's in our DNA. The one who struggles in the early fight, that's the one we pull for, right? That's the hero. That's exactly. the underdog.
You don't, exactly.
Heroes don't start the story at the top. Like, they're the ones that struggle.
Started from the bottom, now we're here.
That's right.
As the song says.
Yeah, and once they get Neo, then the whole team's fucking here.
Exactly. And what's crazy is that this is good storytelling 101.
Yes.
You know, they have not told us anything. What have they told us? He was like, you know, only thing they said was you see a pissing contest between a G-man and a beat cop.
Yeah.
About jurisdiction.
Yeah.
And your men are already dead. There is no exposition here. Right. It is literally like we are automatically just getting dropped right in the middle of this world.
And that is
no clue.
And that is why I love this movie, is that it just starts, and it doesn't give mm-hmm. you a bunch of shit at the top, you know, and it sort of lets you swim in the murky waters of that ambiguity for a long time.
You don't know what's going on until Laurence Fishburn comes on the screen.
Right. So then so after this opening action sequence, we get Neo, who is a hacker and doing all of that stuff.
Mm-hmm. And anyone who was ever really, really super into computers back in those days, you recognize this. You're passed out in front of this too large monitor mm-hmm. because you're waiting for stuff to download. This was before yeah. high-speed internet.
Absolutely.
The fastest modem you had was 56 kbps, mm-hmm. okay? I had a 33.6 for my first computer, my first Windows 95 computer. Yeah,
I remember those too. I remember.
Mm-hmm. So that is not, and he's doing all of his work in the middle of the night so yeah. he can get the fastest bandwidth possible.
And so he keeps seeing mentions of the Matrix and Morpheus and stuff like this, and he's sort of interested in all of that. So it's like it's calling out to him. And so then his computer talks to him.
Now this was the only thing for me that I was like, I was in the theater, I'm like, come on. Alright, now if he's already got headphones on, he must have just been dozing if the change in the screen would wake him up.
Right.
But yeah.
So and then you get like another literary illusion here with the Alice in Wonderland, the screen, whoever's on the other side of it. I guess the implication there is that it's Trinity, right?
It is Trinity. It does end up being Trinity. But, you know, it has you, blah, 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 follow the right white rabbit. And this was among the first times we really got super cryptic something, you know, as we know it today, like the cryptic computer thing.
Yeah.
I mean, not the first time, because we got it in 1980, I think it was 1986, with Jumpin' Jack Flash with Whoopi Goldberg. But it was something along those lines where it's like, okay, what?
Yeah, and you can tell that this is still like very early internet days, because I think that if you make this movie today and you have some stranger message Neo and says, follow the white rabbit, and then you open the door and there's a chick there with a white rabbit tattoo on her shoulder, I think that you definitely do not follow that person.
No. It's like, hey man, we're going to a club. You want to come? I have computer stuff to do.
Right. Yeah, and my connection is way faster because it's 2019 now. So
yeah, so I really don't have to go anywhere. If I want to hang out with people, I can just go on Twitch.
Yeah, right. And so there's this sort of through line here where, you know, we talked about simulation and simulacrum, but there's also this very like sort of Lewis Carroll, Alice in Wonderland byline, the through line as well, where like how far the rabbit hole goes.
But we learn a lot about Neo as well. We see that he's not a good person in the sense that he's a hacker. You know, he's got all this illegal software that he's getting to these guys. And even then, it's like if someone gives you $2,000 for a computer disk, you've done something shady.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, absolutely. He probably forgave all that dude's student loan debt or something.
Oh, man. Well, then if that's the case, Neo, hook a brother up, please.
Right.
Because I'll be paying this off till I'm about 85 or so.
Yeah. So I wanna fast forward a little bit, and it's probably too far of a jump at once. But I want to talk about when. So like Neo is arrested and all this stuff. Like I don't want to talk about all that stuff because whatever.
Yeah, he gets arrested. There's the Gestapo stuff.
Through that moment. Mm-hmm. But when he meets Morpheus and we sort of start the second act of the film, this is where I start to quibble a little bit.
This is when shit starts getting real.
Well, yeah, it does. But I feel
real-ish.
Now, yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. Now, okay. So I read today while I was doing research that the studio required that they do a ton of exposition here to explain the movie. And, okay, fine, I get it. But I will say that the second act of this movie is the one part of the movie that does not hold up for me. The reason for that is because it just kind of bogs you down. Like, once you understand The Matrix, and I think once you've watched it once, that second act is a drag. Because they just explain the same fucking thing over and over and over again so many different ways. You know,
I agree.
Yeah, this movie clocks in at about 2 hours and 20 minutes, and I can absolutely imagine a 1 hour and 45 minute version that's just as good.
I agree 100%. I think when it starts to get a little bit ridiculous is after Neo has woken up on the Nebuchadnezzar.
Yeah.
Now we get beautiful visuals when he first meets Laurence Fishburn, aka Morpheus. And I think the best one for me, and I know you probably think that I'm going to say the mirror scene, but I'm not. What I am going to say is when he gives him the choice between the red pill and the blue pill.
Yeah.
One lens is red, one lens is blue. Right. I think that was expertly done. Him waking up was really well done.
Yep.
I think it really, once again, now you're scared for the guy because now it's like, holy crap. What in the hell? But I definitely agree with you. I think that when Morpheus first takes him into the construct to explain the Matrix to him, at that point, it doesn't feel like exposition. This is now, well, it is exposition, but it's not forced exposition. This is where Neo learns the truth. But after that, it's like...
Yeah, whenever, okay. So, yeah, so, like, whenever he walks into the room and you have the red pill, blue pill thing, like, that's fine. And then the white room, that's fine. Yeah. Whenever he wakes up, and then he takes him back through, like, he does the city street with all the twins and the red dress. And then he does, like, all of this stuff is simply, like, it's essentially just kind of, like, retooling the same stuff again.
Yeah, because he could have done the woman in the red dress thing while they were doing the white room.
Yeah, right, yeah. So, like, this second act, I think, kind of bogs down. I think there should be two versions of this movie. I think there should be a version to the Matrix version and then a veteran to the Matrix version, right?
But, like, I get that, and I totally 100% get where you're coming from with that. But I think that with the way the movie goes, as much as it sucks, if you take some of that exposition out, then it also kind of feels like, huh.
Well, I think sorry, go ahead.
No, I mean, it just kind of feels like, I think the woman in the red dress thing, I think that was a setup to more philosophy when they're at breakfast the next day.
Yeah, you know, I totally understand why the second act is the way that it is. And we mm-hmm. praised the first act for not giving us a bunch of exposition and just dropping us in the middle.
In the second act, it's like overload of exposition.
Yeah, I think that's my real beef with it, is that it's just so much. And is there, because when you were talking, I think, maybe before we came on, about how often Neo just asks what.
And yeah, huh? What?
There's a real solid, like, 20 minutes there where the only, where Morpheus is the only one talking, and the only other lines are Neo saying what.
Huh? What? Huh? Huh?
So, eh? I feel like those 20... I feel like if... I don't know, and... You know, obviously, like, world building is important, and you have to do this, and you do need to explain this stuff, or people are not going to get it. But I don't know a better way to do it, necessarily, because the first time you watch The Matrix, it's absolutely effective, because it's so new. But the second time you watch The Matrix, it just doesn't punch you the same way.
This is Keanu Reeves at the point where you can understand why he's not a big deal in Hollywood, because it's like, huh? What? But it works. It works for him. I couldn't see anyone else doing this, though, because he's being us. What the hell is a squiddy? Where in the hell are we? You know, and it's so, he's like Alice when she first comes into Wonderland.
Yeah, exactly. And that 100% works 100% of the time when you are in Wonderland for the first time.
Exactly. I think that, honestly, and I definitely do agree, and for those who have watched the movie, and if you haven't watched it, you know, you're an Amish person.
Right, and if you haven't watched it in a while, you should give it another shot.
Absolutely. But yeah, you can kind of fast forward through the second act a bit, until it gets to the training scene.
Yeah.
Now, the training scene is great for me because at first, when Tank first comes and gets him, because now we start to understand when Morpheus says, you are the one, when he first talks to him on the phone, we start to learn more about what that is from Tank, and it's not forced exposition, like what I like to refer to as MTV reality show questioning.
Right.
Oh, so how do you think you felt when that happened, when you got pregnant? Well, you know, I was really confused. No, Becky, okay?
Yeah.
No. You know, there was no reality TV interview. It was, I'm fairly excited to see what you're capable of, if Morpheus is right and all. We're not supposed to talk about it, but if you are,
right,
it's a very exciting time. There is nothing really given away. And it's like, you're whetting my appetite to find out what you're talking about, but you're yanking it away when you just go, we have to get to it.
Sort of that moment, adjacent to that moment, is the all-important visit to the... oh my God, I want to say Prodigy, but that's not right.
To the Construct?
Back yeah. Into the
this is a training program.
No, not even the Construct. Oh, it's the,
not even that.
God damn it. I'm going to have to make a note of this moment because I can't even think of it.
Which part?
The Oracle. There it is.
Going to see the Oracle. Yeah.
Going to see
After the training montage, after the downloading sequences.
Yeah.
And then it's finally, we're going back into the Matrix.
Yes.
And now we're seeing the Matrix from a different perspective. Now, did you notice, though, that when he was just a blue pill, it was like, I don't know, it was almost like he was just caught in the crowd. But now, when he goes in back into the Matrix for the first time, there's all this chaos, and it's really strange. It's so crowded and just like almost claustrophobic in a way.
Right.
Did you notice that?
Yeah, I mean, there is clearly like a very striking visual difference between early scenes inside of the Matrix and then these new ones. And I think that probably serves, it serves the viewer as a, like, hey, now we're in on it, right? Like,
right. Now we're in on the secret now. We're in the club.
It's not even that the action inside the Matrix has changed. It's that our awareness is different.
Yeah. And once again, we get another touch of philosophy.
Yeah.
I have all of these memories of my life. What does it mean? That the Matrix can't tell you who or what you are.
Yeah.
But it's like, but that doesn't help in the fact, what about my mom and dad? What about my brothers and sisters? What about all my friends?
Yeah.
You know? But it's almost like the philosophy takes the extensions, and this is where, and correct me if I'm wrong, please, the sort of nihilism of it comes in. None of this other shit matters.
Absolutely.
What matters is you and your perspective.
Yeah, well, and nihilism, goddamn it.
That's another whole show for
I mean, honestly, time. Nihilism's whole perspective is that none of it matters.
Right. And that's the point I'm making. It's like, nothing matters. The only thing, and even like, well, the only difference between it is that while nothing else matters, what does matter is you.
Yeah. All right. So, and I know that we're trying to like breeze through this thing, but so the Oracle tells Neo that he is not the one.
Not the one. You are not.
Right.
You are not the father.
Yeah, exactly. And like, I would have loved a moment, like a Mari moment where like Neo starts like running around like, woo, yeah, like I'm not the one, you know?
You know, and meanwhile, the one chick who goes, these are the other potentials. She's like on the couch.
Yeah, so
the kid with the spoon is like, but you're not my daddy.
Yeah. So now we've all seen the Matrix and we know, like, okay, so she says he's not the one, that that one of them is gonna have to sacrifice their life, right? Eventually Neo decides that his life is the one worth sacrificing, so him and Trinity go back in to try to save Morpheus.
Save Morpheus after Cypher's betrayal and the murder of he firsthand murders Switch and Apoc, which I at first was upset that they didn't get enough character development, but at the same token, they were red shirts. They served their purpose.
Right, they did.
Mouse dies due to the police. Once again, another red shirt. He's the one that gives us human philosophy. He helps us to understand more about what it means to be human, not to give in to our baser instincts.
Right.
You know, and then, of course, Tank, and this is one part that still to this day, how in the hell was he surviving getting shot twice by this freaking electro gun? And then he survives this. And then, you know, it's like, you know, yeah, blah, 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 we're going back into the Matrix. And he's just sitting there like, yep, everything's fine.
Yeah.
But Neo decides, screw it. I don't care if I'm the one or not. I'm saving my boy.
Right, yeah, because Morpheus is the one with all the knowledge and, like, and we need him. So we're going to go back in and get him. We all sort of know how this goes down. Neo gets killed.
Neo goes in. Him and Trinity become the worst domestic terrorists in human history.
Mm-hmm.
They make Timothy McVeigh look like a nice guy.
I mean, they look badass, but they look amazing.
They are not effective. They really, it's just like, holy crap. Look at all this. And blah, blah, blah. And then I think when we first start to see glimpses of Neo as the one was not even the bullet time dodging. That was cool.
Yeah.
But get up, Morpheus, get up, Morpheus, get up. And Morpheus, suddenly he comes out of his haze. It's like Neo wills Morpheus awake.
Right. So let's
just
let's,
like Morpheus did for him.
So let's not ignore the elephant in the room and go ahead and say Neo is absolutely a Christ figure.
There's, he truly is. He's an anagram for one. He is Jesus Christ of this series.
There is too much biblical allusion in this story, in character names, in the name of the ship, in the name of Zion, all of this stuff, right? Like, there's too much to ignore the fact that Neo is absolutely a Jesus Christ character. Calling out to Morpheus, almost like Lazarus, bringing him back, even dying and then being resurrected by Trinity, by all accounts, you know, because when he dies, Trinity says, you can't be dead because you have to be the one, because the Oracle told me that I would fall in love with the one, and I love you. And
wow. And then there we go. He wakes. He survives this. You know. That's something that I stole from because I'm a big fan of the Cinema Sins on YouTube. He survives this. He survives having a Desert Eagle 50 caliber.
Right.
Now, have you ever held a 50 caliber round?
I've not.
They are big as shit. and a standard Desert Eagle magazine, if I recall correctly, can only hold between 7 or 8 rounds. As a matter of fact, I think you get 7 in the clip and 1 in the chamber.
Yeah. Now, here's where I start to quibble a little bit with The Matrix. Now, I want to say I love The Matrix. It's a good time. Mm-hmm. But if you start to think about it and you start to tug on some of these threads a little bit, there are some problems. Because, like, the whole, like, if you die in the Matrix, you die in real life thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, maybe. But, like, it is still just a game, kind of. Like, it's a simulation, you know?
Right.
And so, like, yeah, so he got shot in the Matrix. Did he? I mean, so what?
So your brain, so you can't, if you get shot to shit, if you're jumping from rooftop to rooftop,
right,
like Spider-Man.
Yeah.
But your brain, you can disbelieve the laws of physics, but you can't disbelieve a bullet ripping apart your insides. If I'm going to disbelieve anything, I'm disbelieving my ass dying from being shot.
Right. And so I want to pose, and I don't believe that this is a new theory at all, but I would like to argue that maybe Neo is not the one.
I can get behind that argument. Let's go with this.
And in fact, maybe there is no such thing.
It's just another system of control.
Right.
That's all the one is.
Yeah, and so these enlightened people who have unplugged from the Matrix and who live now in Zion have just created for themselves another system by which they live. I mean, they have a prophet. They have a savior. Mount Zion was the home for Jerusalem in the Bible, right? Like, this was the place this was the holy city. And so it makes complete sense that they would believe, that they would create for themselves a new religion, essentially.
Mm-hmm. I agree 100%. And the thing is, the architect jumped into Matrix Reloaded, but he said essentially that the one is simply the equation trying to balance himself. Well, you look at it, these people waking up, they're already a part of the system, so it doesn't just have to be Neo. It could be anybody, so long as they choose just to disbelieve dying.
Right, that's the
anyone
thing, right?
Can because do it. It's a matter of will. It's like being the Green Lantern. It's a matter of will.
Anybody that's plugged into the Matrix and is self-aware that they're plugged into the Matrix has the ability to manipulate it, right? Like, we see Trinity manipulate it. We see, you know, like, these characters understand that they can, like, shift physics because of their awareness of being plugged in, right? If that's the case, like, Neo just got better at it. Like, that doesn't mean that Trinity couldn't get better at it or that Morpheus couldn't get better at it.
Right.
But I also think that if we talk thematics here, there's a lot to say about how much power comes from other people believing in you. Neo becomes the one, so to speak, because everybody else believes that he's the one. This dude was just some Joe Schmo at the beginning of the
movie. And he has the most plain name, Tom Anderson.
Right.
Why not just name him John Smith while you're at it?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it took Morpheus pounding into his head that he's the one. Trinity basically saying, because I'm in love with you, that makes you the one. It's almost like what it's telling us is that if you believe in something hard enough, you're going to make it come true. The battle of will. So basically, Neo is also, not only is he the one in this computer simulated world because he wants to be, because these people are telling him he is, but he's also a Green Lantern.
Right. And if the philosophy of the movie is not necessarily that we live in a simulation, but that the way that we experience reality is through simulations, then whatever reality you create for yourself is the one that matters.
Exactly.
And to that end, Neo is the one because everyone else believes he is. And because of that external belief, he also in turn believes he is.
Right.
And
he's going to be what they need him to be.
Right. And you could make the argument that he's the one because he's the one that was a blank slate. Like, he didn't have a preconceived notion about what he was. And so it was easier for them to project onto him what he could be.
Right. It's like Morpheus is telling him that he believes that his wait is over and blah, blah, blah. And then as soon as he's told that, he doesn't have time to process it. And now the strange woman just tells him, oh, hey, by the way, you're not the one. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah. Well, then I'm just going to do stuff because I can.
And yeah. And you know, I think part of my... So, like, we've talked about how I have beef with the second act. The only other thing that I have beef with this movie over is how, like, this moment at the end where Trinity tells him that he has to be the one because she loves him and it was prophesied that she would fall in love with the one. Like, this moment feels weak to me. And the reason that it feels weak, and let me defend this position, is it feels a little... It reveals the hand of the writer too much, right? Like, it's a little too deus ex machina for me because, like, if Neo is really the one, then the Oracle should have just said so. And if he's not, then he's not, you know? And so it's a little too, like, it's a little too on the nose, I think.
It's like, so why is he the one? Because the script said so.
Yeah.
And the power of boners means that you are the one. Because this chick wants you so bad, and you want her so bad, that makes you the one. It's like, okay, fine. Hormones make me the one. Great.
Yeah, because, like, look, you know, because just because Neo wants to sling some wieners inside of Trinity does not mean...
Wiener toss.
Right. Now, at least this movie did not give us something called Wiener Time. Bullet time is fine, but wiener time...
Bullet time is bad enough. I don't even want to know what wiener time looks like. Mm. Wiener time is frightening beyond all means because I'm getting a perception of the digital wiener time, and I don't want it.
However, all of this talk of being able to manipulate laws in the Matrix and wieners has given me some pretty good ideas.
All right.
good all right.
for you, man.
So it is time for...
It's time for our ratings.
Plotaholics to rate the Matrix. So here's just a really quick overview of our rating system.
The Plotaholics rating system for the movies is a pretty simple system. Basically, they rate movies based on how many shots it takes to get through them. So if you got a good movie and you get through it all the way sober, then it takes 0 shots to get through the movie. And then if you got a really bad movie, then it could take up to 5 shots to get through the whole thing. I think you can try to figure out the middle part yourself. So, what can I get you?
And, Brian, I will defer to you. You kick us off here. What do you rate The Matrix?
How many shots is it going to take to get through The Matrix?
Yeah.
The sci-fi classic, the cyberpunk philosophy classic.
If you can get through it absolutely sober, then I think that that should be noted, you know?
I can get through this totally sober. And even with the exposition of the second act and how heavy-handed it gets, I think that Joe Pantoliano and just has so much charisma to help us through it. I think that Laurence Fishburne's voice and presence makes it easier to deal with. And I give credit to Marcus Chong and I believe his name is Ray Parker. Yeah, it's Anthony Ray Parker for having the...
No, that's not also, the same guy that wrote the theme song to Ghostbusters.
No, Anthony Ray Parker plays Dozer.
Gotcha.
And Marcus Chong is Tank. And I think their combined presence alone as well makes the exposition-heavy second act easier to get through. I give The Matrix 0 shots. It takes 0 shots for me to get through The Matrix.
That is a really compelling argument for a 0-shot rating.
I will say this. I am not going to regularly give out a 0-shot rating. 0 shots is reserved for special films, and The Matrix just happens to be that one in our second episode.
Yeah, I am going to disagree, but just a little bit, honestly. Mm-hmm. I do not think that The Matrix is a perfect film, but I also think that The Matrix is probably hurt by notes from the studio more than anybody that was directly involved with the making of it.
I agree.
I think that the studio probably made them add a lot of that exposition to make sure that other people would understand it, and that's fine. So I give The Matrix out of it doesn't take a lot to get through, but it's going to take me 1 shot to get through that second act, probably.
Fair enough.
And I stand by that. And, you know, maybe I'll do like a half shot at the end whenever Trinity says that bullshit about falling in love with the one.
That one, I need a shot. I do need. I'll. You know what? I will. So you're giving it 1.5
shots.
I'm
going to give it 1.5 shots.
I'll give it a half of a shot for that, because that was bullshit.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. It is bullshit. So, you know what? It doesn't get 0 shots. It gets half of a shot. 0.5.
That scene is just a little too telegraphed. You know,
that's too much of, so why is he the one? Plot!
Yeah, and that's another moment also, right? Yeah, so like it becomes, I think that moments like that in movies really take the audience out of it. The same can go for novels too, right? Because like, it becomes so obvious that this is a story. Mm-hmm. And you're not just watching something happen, right? And so,
absolutely,
I think that moment can be effective on a first watch, but that moment especially becomes increasingly painful the more you watch it.
I think it would have been better if he got shot up, he got turned into Swiss cheese, and as the agents walked away and they're looking at him and his vitals are done, if his heart beat on its own.
Yeah.
And then he basically gets up to finish off Smith without Trinity's little thing.
Yeah, you know, Trinity, like, she's pretty androgynous, and we talked about that a little bit. Mm-hmm. But it's the fact that she attaches like a romantic element to it.
And it wasn't necessary.
Not at all. It hadn't been there. I mean, there was tension between these two characters. But the idea that, like, suddenly she loves him, no. And I also think it gives him more credence as the one. Like, I would be more compelled to say that Neo is the one if he resurrects himself.
Absolutely.
And because he had this outside sort of, I don't know, like Beauty and the Beast sort of moment, you know.
It's tainted.
Yeah,
it's an asterisk.
It's a little, yeah, it is. It's an asterisk. It's performance-enhancing vagina.
Yep, pretty much.
And so pretty to that much. End, yeah, I stand by my 1.5 shot rating for
and
the
I'll,
Matrix.
And I'll definitely go for, you know what, I'll go, you know what, I'll actually make it a full shot. So I give it a 1, you're giving it a 1 point. I flip-flop twice, I'm standing firm at the 1.
There you go.
1, it's an anagram for Neo.
What?
Whoa!
Wait a minute. Okay. Given this new information, I think we're going to have to redo the whole podcast.
Oh my God.
Oh man. No.
That's going
to
be fun.
No, that is a good conversation, and I think that's as fine a place as any to end our talk about the Matrix on this 20th anniversary. I don't anticipate us talking about either of the other Matrix films.
I'd rather not.
Anytime soon, anyway.
I'd rather wait a while. I want to get some more good movies on our belt.
Absolutely.
Before we go to these train wrecks. Because they totally take the philosophy in everything and just go, hey, this is some great toilet paper. But I digress.
And you know, also, I like the part where they decided that the architect was going to be Colonel Sanders.
Oh my God, yeah.
The best thing about the architect was the MTV Movie Awards sketch where Will Ferrell played him.
Oh, God, yes. And what I really love, though, is you can't control me, you old white prick. It's like, but you're white.
Right.
I don't understand.
I do want to say one other thing, and that is that the end of The Matrix clearly... anticipates the sequel. That's how I read it, right? Neo on the phone saying, I'm going to take it to the machines, whatever, and then he flies off.
But he doesn't, but they don't do it. I mean, and you find out they don't do it. I'm thinking when the sequel comes out, there's going to be some shit going on. And it's just like, yeah, we're hiding in the sewers, wearing our sunglasses at night because we're scared.
Yeah, and so I think if you remove the sequels and you make The Matrix a standalone film, I think that you still keep the ending, though, because I like the...
Oh, yes, absolutely.
I like my brain's imagined sequels way more than the actual sequels.
Absolutely. Not to mention the fact that having that ending the way it did with Free Your Mind by... Rage Against the Machine playing, one of the most anti-authority rock bands ever, up there with Anthrax and Dead Kennedys.
Yeah,
playing at the end.
Love Rage Against the Machine.
Love Rage Against the Machine. That was the perfect ending right there.
Yeah, yeah, and I will. We will pivot into our gratuitous self-promotion after this final thought. And that final thought is, are the overlords that bad if they allow you to think that life is good?
You know what? I look at it like this. Slavery is slavery, even if you think you're enjoying yourself. But at the same token, I'd rather have fake steak than cream of wheat every day.
Fuck cream of wheat. Because when you unplugged and you went into Zion, like, that life sucked. Like,
that life is not... What do you have to listen for? What do you have to live for? Half-naked rave night in the cave while you're eating oatmeal?
Now, I will say that going back into the Matrix with the knowledge that it is manipulated, like, that you can manipulate it, like, now, that's a life I could get into.
Yeah. That I would be cool with. But it's just... I mean, I don't know.
It's just red dresses all day.
Right, and I'll tell you the truth, and I don't want to start a whole new conversation because you have stuff you need to do, and so do I. But I will say this. I can understand Cypher's thinking and why he did what he did.
Absolutely.
I understand why he did it. He's cold. He's tired of fighting. He's tired of constantly being on edge. He's tired of having to drink engine degreaser.
Yeah, and you know, like, and that's why I didn't really bring him up too much. This is my thought, right? Like, so the machines have decided to use humans for power. And if that's what they want to do, like, they could legitimately just use us for power. They don't, if that was their prerogative, they don't have to give us any semblance of a good life. But they've bestowed upon us a certain level of comfort through these projections into our brain, and I'm like kind of okay with it.
That's not bad. And honestly, we don't deserve it if we're the ones that scorched the sky. I want to know who was in the war room with the president that thought that was a good idea.
Yeah,
hey, honestly, man, let's scorch the sky. What about our food and water? To hell with that. We have to beat these damn robots. Yeah. I'm not going to be fighting with no Atari 2600.
I'm not so sure that the protagonist of this series isn't the machines.
They truly are.
And that's why it can't end after the first one, because the machines don't win.
Right. Well, the thing is, I think that also at the end of the day, what it truly is that Agent Smith says it best. And when I heard him have his speech on why he hates humans and why he hates the Matrix, I'm thinking to myself, you know what? He has a damn good point.
Yeah.
So this movie really makes you stop and it makes you think a lot. And it makes you question yourself as a human being and human beings as a whole.
Yeah. Well, Brian, I think that's going to have to wrap it up for us tonight.
Absolutely. For tonight.
I am Shane Wilson. That's Brian Tan. Brian, tell the people where they can find you.
Well, you can definitely find the both of us at Plotaholics on Twitter and on Facebook. You can find me personally at briantan.com. That is my website, briantan.com. With all of my writing, find me at Brian Tan Author on Facebook and on Twitter, and Author Brian Tan on Instagram.
Very good. And I am Shane Wilson, and I would echo Brian on the Plotaholics stuff. If you if you see us posting something, respond to it. You might hear your response read on a future podcast. I'd like to get into some of that where we're reading, listener feedback.
Yeah, absolutely. Give us your feedback. And, if you sell us something good, we'll give you a shout out. If you act like a jagoff, we're probably going to make fun of you.
There you go. Absolutely. But I'm Shane Wilson. You can find me all over the internet at that Shane Wilson. I'm sorry. Is that what it's called? Yeah. at that Shane Wilson on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. You can also find me on the interwebs in general at ShaneWilsonAuthor.com. We will be back in a couple of weeks with Endgame. So, hope to see everybody then. And, for the Plotaholics, I'm Shane Wilson.
I'm Brian Tan.
And we will talk at you again real soon.
Later.